what you're going to find is with this course, it's different than really anything else that we've looked at in Genesis before, in that it really concentrates on God's covenant relationship with man, beginning, of course, with Israel, with Abraham and Israel, and eventually, of course, the church. That's the main thrust of this. So Kevin's just going to read out one or two things off there, which will set the scene, hopefully. This mic's a bit too loud, Chris. Can you bring the main volume down? Okay, Kev.
Okay. Why does God begin the Bible with the creation of the universe? If the Bible is a book of theology for the Jews, why not begin with the creation of the Jewish nation and go immediately to the story of Exodus? That's when the Jews become a nation, get the Torah, and go into the land. Rashi answers that. In the future, the nations of the world will accuse the Jewish people of being thieves, saying, "You have stolen the land from the Canaanite nations." God begins the Bible here, at the creation of the universe, to tell the world, "I am the creator of the universe. Everything is mine. I choose to give the land of Israel to the Jewish people."
Now that's probably a completely different way of looking at it than perhaps we would as a church. But Rashi, who is one of the great scholars, which we'll come to him when we go through the history, I think makes a great case there. He's basically saying the only reason why God talks about the creating the heavens and the earth is when the problem comes as to who that land belongs to. He refers back and says, wait a minute, the God that created the heavens and the earth gave the Jews that land. Is that a problem today? 6,000 years later? Oh yes, it's still a problem. Does God still want the Jewish people to inherit that land? Yes. According to the promises in the Old Testament? Yes, he does. So, just go on to the next one, thanks. Okay.
On January the 16th, 1996, then President of Israel, Isa Weisman, gave a speech to both Houses of Parliament of Germany. He gave this speech in Hebrew to the Germans, 50 years after the Holocaust, and in it he beautifully summed up what Jewish history is. He said, "It was fate that delivered me and my contemporaries into this great era when the Jews returned to re-establish their homeland."
Press it again, man.
"I am no longer a wandering Jew who migrates from country to country, from exile to exile, but all Jews in every generation must regard themselves as if they had been there in previous generations, places and events. Therefore, I am still a wandering Jew, but not along the far-flung paths of the world. Now I migrate through the expanses of time, from generation to generation, again, down the paths of memory."
And again.
"I was a slave in Egypt. I received the Torah on Mount Sinai, together with Joshua and Elijah. I crossed the Jordan River. I entered Jerusalem with David and was exiled with Zedekiah. And I did not forget it by the rivers of Babylon. When the Lord returned the captives of Zion, I dreamed among the builders of its ramparts. I fought the Romans and was banished from Spain. I was bound to the stake in Mainz. I studied Torah in Yemen and lost my family in Kishinev. I was incinerated in Treblinka, rebelled in Warsaw, and emigrated to the land of Israel, the country from where I have been exiled and where I have been born and from which I come and to which I return. I am a wandering Jew who follows in the footsteps of my forebearers, and just as I escort them there and now and then, So do my forebears accompany me and stand with me here today. I am a wandering Jew with the cloak of memory around my shoulders and the staff of hope in my hand. I stand at the great crossroads in time at the end of the 20th century. I know whence I come, and with hope and apprehension I attempt to find out where I'm heading. We are all people of memory and prayer. We are people of words and hope. We have neither established empires nor built castles and palaces. We have only placed words on top of each other. We have fashioned ideas. We have built memorials. We have dreamed towers of yearning, of Jerusalem rebuilt, of Jerusalem united, of a peace that will swiftly and speedily establish us in our days. Amen.
One more, Kev.
David Ben-Gurion, the first Prime Minister of the State of Israel, a Jew who does not believe in miracles, is not a realist. Why did he say that? Because miracles are the only possible explanation for the existence of the Jewish people. Over 300 years ago, King Louis XIV of France asked Blaise Pascal, the great French philosopher, to give him proof of the supernatural. Pascal answered, "Why the Jews, Your Majesty? The Jews." An astonishing answer. The best proof of the supernatural that Pascal could think of was the Jews.
Okay. Thanks, Kevin. It's absolutely fantastic. Right. So, just press this, press it down again. That's a Mr. Slinky. Does everybody know what a Mr. Slinky is? A Slinky?
Yeah.
So basically, this Slinky represents the positive and negative repetitions that the nation of Israel has been through over the last 4,000 years or so. So to give you an example of the good repetitions that they go through every year would be the Seven Feasts of Israel. Every year the Jews will celebrate the feast, and the idea is that the next year builds on the last year. It's not just a repetition. As you go through your life, you get more mature and more mature. Yes, it's a repetition, but every year the Jewish people learn more about what those feasts really mean. That's a good kind of repetition. But also, as we'll see as the weeks go by, there are many tragic kinds of repetition. One of them is, whenever they prosper in a nation, they're normally exiled from that nation. And you see this happen again and again and again. It's a repetition. The other big repetition with Israel is when they sin against God, they always come up against the judgment of God. It's another repetition. Okay, Mandy. Thanks, Kev. You were all right, right, mate. Thank you. So let's have a look at the history of Israel. This is just obviously part one. Now, none of the others are going to be, the others are going to be shorter than this, and we'll look at things in more detail. The reason why I'm shooting through this is because you know this stuff. So with the Jews, and of course with the Christians, the first part of their history is our history. We have the same history. From Abraham right the way through to what we would say John the Baptist, we share the same history. Okay, Mand. Now then, the call of Abraham. I just turn very quickly to Genesis chapter 12.
The call of Abraham.
Immediately you will see a difference between the way that Jews interpret their history and the way that as Christians we interpret history. So it says in Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 to 3, "Now the Lord had said to Abraham, get out of your country and from your family, from your father's house, to a land I will show you. I will make you a great nation. I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you shall be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you. I will curse him who curses you. And in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed." Everybody knows the call of Abraham. But what you find with the Jewish writings is that Abraham chose God, and therefore God chose Abraham. In the Jewish writings, that's very much how it seems to be. In other words, Abraham had to do something right in order for God to say, now I choose you. So this is a way that one Jewish writer puts it. Abraham, in effect, said to God, I choose to live with the reality of you and to bring all humanity back to that reality. God then said to Abraham, then I choose you and your descendants. Do you see the difference between the two? So from a Jewish perspective, Abraham had to do something right. He had to make the first move in order for God to say, you're my man, I now choose you. From the perspective of the New Testament, of course, Jesus tells us in John chapter 15, you did not choose me, I chose you. So right at the very outset of Jewish history, it is very different. And what it boils down to, of course, is that Jewish history is based on good works. And of course, the history of Christianity is based on God's grace. God's grace. Amazing. And when you begin to let that sink in, folks, it will really, it'll help you to understand a lot of things. So, when you look at Adam and Eve, they fell, Cain and Abel came along, Cain murdered Abel, eventually there was a population explosion. In Genesis chapter 6, there was wickedness all over the place, wasn't there? God flooded the world. There was idolatry on an incredible level. You get to the Tower of Babel. They were worshipping all kinds of gods. And so Abraham comes along in accordance with Jewish history, and says, wait a minute, all you guys are wrong. God is one. It is a monotheistic God. It's not like the Mesopotamian gods from Iraq. He is one, and I choose to follow him. And so then God chose him. You see the difference between the Jewish and the Christian faith. So Abraham was called from Mesopotamia, which is like Babylon, Iraq. He then spent some time in Haran, which is the Syrian and the southern Turkish border, actually, which is where Aleppo is, where all the trouble is at the moment. He finally gets to Canaan, and God says to him, this is it, you've arrived. And then there's a famine. That's our God, isn't he? He's always testing our faith. So he'd arrived, but there was a famine. God doesn't speak. So Abraham makes the decision to go down to Egypt, where there was plenty of food. Abraham goes down to Egypt, and of course he tells his wife Sarah, please pretend to be my sister, because if you don't, Pharaoh will take you and he'll kill me. And she says, okay, I'll go along with that. So Sarah becomes part of into Pharaoh's palace. And of course, God plagues Pharaoh, and Pharaoh comes to Abraham and says, what were you doing? What were you even thinking of? And Sarah comes back to Abraham, but as Abraham and Sarah leave Egypt, Abraham takes another wife, and her name, of course, is Hagar. Hagar. Now, in Jewish tradition, Hagar is Pharaoh's daughter. So they come back to Bethel, where they've started, the house of God. There was an altar there. And they start to prosper. And Lot begins to argue a bit with Abraham. And of course, Abraham says, look, Lot, I don't want to argue with you. Go whichever way you want to go. And of course, Lot sees Sodom and Gomorrah and he thinks, this is beautiful. Off he goes down that way. Ultimately, Abraham has to save him, doesn't he? Has to rescue him. God promises Abraham and Sarah that they're going to have a miracle child. The problem is that Sarah's barren. Now, this is why at the very beginning here, we had all these quotes about Israel as a nation being a miracle. Because at its very outset, it was a complete miracle. Of course, Sarah was barren, and a nation had to come from that barrenness. Sarah, whether she had a lack of faith, or whether she actually thought, well, maybe God's in the fact that Hagar's here now. Who knows? Actually, we all do it at times in our lives. We all kind of justify our lack of faith, and we've all had spiritual Hagars. And of course, Hagar became the surrogate wife to Abraham. Who was born from this? Ishmael. The Arabs tell us that they are the descendants of Ishmael. And if the Arabs are the descendants of Ishmael, and they believe they are, and Muhammad, the Prophet Muhammad, believes he's a direct descendant of Ishmael, then the whole Islamic problem, which we're going to be looking at in this study, goes back to Abraham and Sarah's lack of faith. Amazing, isn't it? If you turn to Genesis, if somebody wants to read nice and loud, Genesis 16, verse 12.
He shall be a wild man. His hand shall be against every man, and every man's hand against him. And he shall dwell in the presence of all his brethren.
He shall be a wild man. His hand will be against everybody. Their hand will be against him. You've only got to look at the Middle East today, and you can see that all these years further on, that prophecy still stands, most certainly. Let's move on, folks. Abraham and Sarah eventually have their promised son. Remember, Sarah laughs? Sarah laughs, and a year later, of course, they have the promised son. Well, then God tests Abraham's faith. Now, this is interesting because I was saying to Mandy earlier on, as Christians, and rightly so, we want to see Jesus on every page of the scriptures, don't we? And we see Jesus as a shadow in so many things. So when we see Abraham sacrificing Isaac, as Christians, we see that foreshadowing. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. I'm so used to that. So used to seeing that when you see Abraham and Isaac. But from a Jewish point of view, they don't see that at all. And it's kind of quite shocking that they don't see that. The Bible tells us in Romans 11:25, there is a partial blindness at this moment in time, and there really is. Eventually, Isaac marries Rebekah, and Isaac prospers. He prospers so much that he sows. Does anybody know how much he sowed in 1 year? Isaac sowed 100-fold in 1 year. And Abimelech said, get away from me. You know, you're far too successful. But then when Isaac went away, Abimelech began to suffer. His nation began to go down. He says, listen, I'm better off when you're with me. This is a microcosm of the Jews as they go through the nations. You're going to see this again and again and again. The Jews do bless the nations. So, ultimately, Isaac and Rebekah have twins. And Rebekah wants to know why there's so much rumbling going on in her tummy. And God says it's because you've got two nations in there. One of them's Israel, and the other we know as Edom or Amalek. Now, I'm not going to go into this now, but this is important. Many Jewish historians believe that Edom, which is a descendant of Esau, Amalek was Israel's sworn enemies. In fact, God said that they're to wipe the Amalekites out. They are their sworn enemies. There is nothing but absolute hatred between Amalek and Israel. Now, this will make much more sense as we get into the Middle Ages, the Dark Ages. But the Jews believe that the descendants of Edom eventually, in some form, become Rome. Where's it going to with this? Well, they say our worst enemies are our closest in the family. And the people that treated the Jews the worst in the Middle Ages were the Christians, which we just don't see. So Esau's the oldest of the two. He should be inheriting the birthright. But of course, It's Jacob, it's the younger one that has the real hunger for the birthright. Esau's out hunting, comes back, Jacob's made him this big pot of stew and says, sell me your birthright. Esau says, well, what use is that birthright to me anyway? I'm starving. And of course he takes the bowl, he eats it and just throws it away. New Testament talks an awful lot about this point. It's a very purposeful point in the history of Israel. So Esau rejects his own birthright. Years later, Jacob then deceives Isaac to get the birthright from Esau. Remember how he did it? Jacob goes into Isaac and he puts on skins, doesn't he? Puts this hair all over him. And what does Isaac say? Isaac says, this smells like Esau, this feels like Esau, but this is the voice of Jacob. And yet, it tells us in the New Testament that by faith, he blessed Jacob. He blessed Jacob. I believe, I can't prove this, but I believe that Isaac knew that Jacob would be the better of the two to cause this nation to multiply and spread and go forward. He was smarter. He was the smarter of the two. Well, Esau is enraged. He wants to kill his brother, Jacob. Jacob means deceiver. Jacob's mum says, you need to go off to your uncle Laban now. Get out of the way for a bit. Lie low. So off goes Jacob. And he goes to a place called Bethel and he falls down. Do you remember? He goes asleep and he has this stone as a pillar and he sees a vision of the ladder going up into heaven. Now, interestingly enough, the Jews believe that that was Mount Moriah. And they believe it was Mount Moriah because Jacob said, well, this is the very gateway to God. And of course, Mount Moriah is where the temple was. So they believe that that's where Jacob had this vision. Ultimately, he goes to his uncle Laban, and his uncle Laban does to him what Jacob did to his brother. His uncle Laban deceives him. Jacob sees this absolutely stunning lady, falls in love with her instantly, and he says, I want to marry her. So he works 7 years for her, but Laban has a veil over Leah. He marries Leah, and he finds out in the morning he's married the wrong one. So his uncle Laban says, it's okay, you can have Rachel, but you're going to have to work another 7 years for me. Ultimately, they end up with 12 sons, which become the 12 tribes of Israel. Jacob arrived at his uncle's, this is very important, he arrived at his uncle's flat broke, he got nothing. He left that place very wealthy. It is a microcosm of Jewish history. They always go in broke, and God always seems to bless them, and they come out wealthy. Well, now he's got to go back and face the music. Esau's waiting for him. So Jacob sends out three parcels of people with presents and all kinds of, all bowing down and all this kind of stuff. But before he goes across to see Esau, he wrestles all night with the angel of the Lord. And he says, Jacob says to the angel of the Lord, I will not let go of you until you bless me. Yeah. So of course, the angel of the Lord blesses Jacob and he says, you will no longer be called Jacob, which means deceiver. Your name is going to be Israel, which means prince. Prince. I mean, we can see the absolute grace and election of God in this, can't we? You'll find from a Jewish perspective that always has to be a good reason why there was a blessing. But let's move on. So, of course, Jacob has a favourite son, doesn't he? Joseph! Joseph's given a really wonderful multicoloured robe. And, of course, he's favoured by Jacob. Joseph then gives a bad report of his brothers, remember? Tells on them, he grasses on his brothers. Then he says, I've had two dreams. And he tells his brothers, I've had two dreams. And in both dreams, I am ruling over you lot. Well, of course, the first chance they get, they throw him into a pit. Now, from a Jewish point of view, to try to justify what the brothers did, they say, well, maybe Joseph was another Ishmael or Esau. Maybe Joseph was another bad apple, because they always seem to have a bad apple in every generation. And therefore, what the brothers were doing, really, is just getting rid of the bad apple. Now, of course, you look at this situation, it's obvious why they tried to kill Joseph. It was jealousy. Ultimately, he sold as a slave into Egypt. He went into Egypt. This is Joseph now, not Jacob. This is another one. He went into Egypt with nothing. Potiphar hires him as a slave. Within no time, he becomes the head servant. Remember, in the Bible it says, and God was with Joseph. God was with Joseph. He goes from nothing to the head servant. Potiphar's wife, he's a very handsome man as Joseph. And Potiphar's wife tries to seduce him. She grabs hold of his garment. Joseph flees from her, rips the garment. She cries rape. Potiphar doesn't believe her, because if he did believe her, Joseph would have been killed. No doubt about that. But he's sent to prison. So he goes from nothing to head servant to nothing again. This is a microcosm of Jewish history. So he goes into prison. There's a cupbearer there. There's a bread maker in there. They both have dreams. He goes in there as a nothing. And he's now in charge of the prisoners. Unbelievable. And God was with Joseph. They both have dreams. Joseph interprets the dreams. One of you is going to live, one of you is going to die. And he says to the cupbearer, remember me when it all goes well for you. Please remember me. I'm stuck in this place. I've done nothing wrong. One Jewish writer said that the Jews have never been able to count on Gentiles for help. And this here proves it. Ultimately, Pharaoh has a dream. 2 years later, Joseph's stuck in this place, and the cupbearer says, oh, I remember now. Yes, that's right, I was supposed to put a good word in for you. Joseph's taken out, he's shaved, head shaved, beard shaved off, and he is brought before Pharaoh. Pharaoh has two dreams, doesn't he? He has a dream of the wheat. The wheat was very plump, and then it became very barren. Then he had a dream of cows, seven cows, plump, then barren. Joseph says, I totally understand what's going on here. You're going to have 7 years of prosperity followed by 7 years of famine. And Joseph actually takes the initiative to then say to Pharaoh what you need to do. Unbelievable. Incredible. He didn't even wait to be asked. He said, what you need to do is appoint wise men. You need to store up food for the famine. You need to make great grain barns and so on. And Pharaoh says, is there anybody in the kingdom that could possibly do this better than you? And he becomes the prime minister of Egypt. He goes in there as a slave and he rises to be the prime minister. It's a microcosm of the Jewish nation as they go through into Europe and so on. The famine gets that bad that Jacob's sons go to Egypt. Do you remember? When they go to Egypt, they do not recognize Joseph, because Joseph looks like an Egyptian. They don't recognize him. Now, as Christians, we see something in this. We see that this is a picture of the Jews the first time not recognizing Jesus the first time he comes. But when Joseph later reveals himself to them, they get it and they weep. And of course, there's this wonderful restoration and forgiveness and so on. Okay, Mandy, next slide. 70 people go into Egypt. 3 million come out. It's just another picture of God's hand upon this nation. Upon the Abrahamic covenant. Remember when Abraham went through when God went through the covenant, Abraham was fast asleep. Um, Because of the population explosion, the Bible records that there was a new Pharaoh on the scene who knew not Joseph. Because he didn't know Joseph, he realized if we don't do something about these guys, they're going to take over this nation. Again, it's another microcosm of Jewish history. And of course, they start to enslave them and they start to kill the Jewish boys. Moses' mother finds out about this. Moses is born. The Bible records that he's a beautiful boy. They try to hide him, but after 3 months, they can't anymore. She makes a little mini ark for Moses and basically puts him down by faith and trusts God that this child is going to be kept. And of course, Moses' mother is actually allowed to look after her when Pharaoh's daughter picks him up, draws him up out of the water. The word Moses means to be drawn out of the water. So Moses was trained in all the Egyptian arts and culture, and yet, because his mother was always there, he never forgot his people. So one day, of course, Moses is going out, he's looking around at his people, he sees an Egyptian treating his people harshly, and he murders the Egyptian. He looks this way, he looks that way. Bible says he hid him in the sand. The next day he goes out again. He sees two of his brothers fighting against one another. Moses says, why would you be doing this when life is that hard anyway? And they say, who are you? Why do you think you're a ruler over us? Moses realizes at that point he's got to get out of there. He's going to be in real trouble. And off he goes. And of course, he eventually comes across this kind of renegade priest called Jethro. He gets to Jethro, he marries Zipporah, black lady I think, and he comes to the burning bush, which is at the foot of Mount Sinai. And of course he receives the call of God. And he's told that he's got to go back to Egypt. And the message is this. You're to go back and tell Pharaoh, let my people go. Of course, Pharaoh's not going to let them go. Moses goes with his rod. The Pharaoh's magicians come with their rod. Moses throws his rod down. It turns to a snake. They throw their rods down. They turn into snakes. It doesn't impress Pharaoh at all. Now, this teaches us that back then, spirituality was on a much, much, much higher level than it is today. And the Bible tells us, in the days to come, spirituality will once again go up to a much higher level. But then, it didn't impress them. It didn't impress Pharaoh, all the plagues. These supernatural plagues didn't impress him. Why? Because the ancient cultures understood the spirit world. His refusal to let Israel go is similar to Hitler in the Second World War. He needed trains to send reinforcements to the Eastern Front in Russia. He was losing the war. He needed those trains to get soldiers to the Eastern Front. But his hatred for the Jews was so intense, he would rather send those trains to ship Hungarian Jews to Auschwitz. He lost the war because of his hatred for the Jews. Pharaoh lost this fight because of his hatred for the Jews. Ultimately, after the plagues comes Passover, and anybody who didn't have the blood of the lamb over the doorpost, the firstborn of course, perished. I heard Donald Trump said something the other day about terrorism, and he said these guys might be frightened of nothing, but they're frightened of their family being killed. This is what God did. The very last thing he did is he touched the family of Pharaoh, and that was it. He said, go. Off you go. We come to the Red Sea, and of course the Red Sea opens. Moses says, stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. Red Sea opens. Egypt was the birthing womb for the nation of Israel. That's what it was. They come to the foot of Mount Sinai, to the very place where Moses received his call in the first place at the burning bush. That's where they end up. They come to the foot of Mount Sinai. This is the beginnings of the Torah, but we'll look at this later, not in this study. It's also the beginnings of the oral laws. I'm nearly there, folks. Ultimately, after 40 days, he comes down off the mountain, and of course, there's all kinds of idolatry. Moses smashes the commandments. He's commanded to build the tabernacle. They get through the wilderness. They come to the shores of the Jordan, and now is the time. The 12 spies are sent out into the land. 10 spies come back and say, yeah, everything's wonderful. The grapes are massive, but you should see the people that are eating the grapes. They're as big as the grapes are big. Yes, the place is enormous, but so are the people. We can't do it. Joshua and Caleb, we can do it. No, we can't do it. And of course, the majority won. This is very, very important. On the date that they decided that they were not going to cross into the land that God had promised Abraham, right at the beginning. Right at the beginning, this land that he was going to give them, on that very date that they turned around and said, we're not doing it, the first temple was destroyed on that same day, the 9th of Av. First temple was destroyed. The second temple was destroyed by the Romans on exactly the same date. The Bar Kokhba revolt was crushed by Rome on exactly the same date that they decided they weren't going to take that land. The first crusade was launched on that exact same date that they decided they were not going to take that land. The Jews were expelled from England on the exact same date, and the Jews were expelled from Spain on the exact same date. The repercussions of not taking that land were massive. Okay, Mandy, crack on. We get to Joshua. So God said to Abraham, go to a land that I will show you. Joshua is one of the faithful. They cross the Jordan. The walls of Jericho fall in. That tells you that this was not your usual rape and pillage kind of thing. It was totally different than the wars and the sieges that were going on at that time. It was a supernatural war, a divine battle. God said to them, don't take any booty, no raping, no pillaging. This is not normal. This God is completely different than the other idols around about. So completely different. In the end, the land is divided up roughly between 12 tribes. Joshua dies. And when Joshua dies, they start to go into a landslide. We see it in the book of Judges, don't we? The book of Judges is just up and down, up and down, up and down. And in the book of Judges, the main three in the book of Judges are Deborah, Gideon, and Samson. But ultimately, the end of the book of Judges says this: everyone did what was right in their own eyes. It was a time of apostasy. Samuel becomes the last judge and the first prophet. He grows up, becomes a mighty prophet, but the Jews ask for a king like the other nations. It breaks God's heart. It breaks Samuel's heart. God says to Samuel, they've not rejected you, they've rejected me. And they were given Saul. And of course, Saul was very disobedient, lacked faith. Eventually, Saul fell on his own sword, and David, of course, the Bible declares, had a heart after God's own heart. Ultimately, David slays Goliath. Saul hates him for that. He goes into the wilderness for 10 years. But after an awful lot of time and patience, David becomes the king of Israel, and he ultimately takes Jerusalem. When he takes Jerusalem, he buys that parcel of land of which the temple would be built on. Solomon becomes the next king, and we go into the golden age. This is the golden age. Peace on every border. The temple was built, stunning, but unfortunately Solomon, in the latter end of his life, had many, many wives, the Bible records, and he brings his wives in, his wives bring all their gods in, and right at the end of Solomon's life, it actually records that Solomon did wicked in the eyes of the Lord. And some of the things he got up to were ridiculous. So God said to Solomon, I'm going to tear your kingdom in two. Not in your day, for the sake of your father David. Not for you, but for the sake of your father David. Then you move into a time where the house of God was divided. Press the thing. So you end up with 10 tribes up in the north, 2 tribes in the south. You end up with 2 leaders that can't stand one another, Mandy. Rehoboam and Jeroboam. This apostasy went on for 220 years. It was dreadful. Jeroboam didn't want anybody going down south where the temple was, so he set up 2 false temples to try and stop them from going. It was awful. God sent Elijah and Elisha to the northern kingdoms. You'd think that would do it, wouldn't you? But it didn't. Nothing changed. So in 555, I'm using their calendar, BCE, the Assyrians overrun the northern Israel. 120 years later, the same thing happened to southern Israel. Even though in southern Israel, there were many good kings, weren't there? Like Hezekiah and Josiah. Nevertheless, 42 BC, the Babylonians came along this time and they destroyed the temple. The Jews go into Babylon, for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and so on. That's about this, Jeremiah 29. Build houses, marry. You're going to be in there a long time. There's no way out of this. You're going into Babylon. Off they go. But they prosper. They prosper in Babylon. The Jews always seem to prosper. And they always seem to be persecuted when they've prospered. So then you have Daniel. Daniel is just like Joseph. Goes in with nothing, ends up being second in command. Unbelievable. At the end of the Babylonian reign, you have King Belshazzar that thinks that the 70 years are up and that the Jews are not going to go back. He miscalculates the dates, he has a great party, brings out all the Jewish utensils, and he mocks God, and there's this eerie writing on the wall that says, you have been weighed in the balances and found wanting. That night, Babylon was taken by the Medes and the Persians. They diverted the river Tigris on a dry bed. They went through and they took the place. It happened. The whole thing fell without a battle. Weighed in the balances and found wanting. Terrifying scripture. 370 BCE, the Jews returned to Israel after 70 years. During that time, there were those that didn't return. So you've got the situation with Queen Esther and, of course, Vashti, who was told to parade in front of the king. She wouldn't do it. Esther is raised for such a time as this. She's a young Jewess. You've got Mordecai, her uncle, and Haman, who was part of Amalek. Remember, Saul was supposed to kill King Agag, and he didn't kill King Agag. They were their sworn enemies. And of course, this enemy always rises up against the Jews. So, you know what happens? Praise God. God, in the end, hangs Haman on the gallows that were prepared for Mordecai. Amazing. There's a wonderful sermon in that. We call this the Feast of Purim. It should have been a genocide. God saved Israel again. Meanwhile, the construction of the temple was going on in 352 BCE. Who was involved in that? Joshua and Zerubbabel. We're looking at that on a Sunday, aren't we? The two prophets involved in that were Haggai and Zechariah. Two completely different prophets. Haggai was very blunt. Zechariah was very poetic. First temple period was 410 years. And the second temple period was about 420 years. In the first temple period, there was only 18 priests because they were faithful priests. They lived a long time. In the second temple period, after the Maccabees, we'll look at this next week, it works out there were 300 priests over 420 years. Bearing in mind that the first three priests actually lived quite some time, it works out that for the last 300 years of the Second Temple period, it was almost one priest a year, right? And they would put a rope around him as he went in to the holy place, because the likelihood was it was a time of apostasy. God was going to kill him. And virtually every single year, a new high priest went in and they dragged him out as a corpse. That's how bad things had got at this time. Bearing in mind, there's no mercy seat. It's a sad time. Terrible time. No mercy seat's gone. History says that Josiah, he knew what was coming and he hid the Ark of the Covenant somewhere. The high priests were killed almost every year. Now this is it. We're done.
They had bells on there.
They had bells. They did. Yes. Yeah. 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 That's right. Now they were in Jewish history. They are very aware that at this. This is the important bit. They are very aware at this time that prophecy had ceased. Prophecy had ceased. The prophets had gone. There was no move of God as such. And they say that prophecy will not return until the Messianic era. Now, please, this has been way longer than I thought. And believe you me, I've been on this all day. I've tried to get it down to... But this is the thing here, folks. They believed that prophecy would be restored in the Messianic era, right? Now, according to the Jews, that still hasn't happened. So they're 2,400 years from there now. And prophecy has still not been restored. However, this is the wonder. If you turn to Matthew, this is the last scripture, folks. I promise you. God bless you. And I promise you it won't be longer than 15 minutes each week from here on in. Matthew. Please look at the Gospel of Matthew. Did you see that we've gone through the whole history of Israel? Do you notice that the first page of what the Christians call the New Covenant is a genealogy that goes from Jesus to Abraham? Wonderful. Wonderful. When you get to chapter 3, Messiah comes on the scene. Now, of course, the Jews don't believe that our Jesus is the Messiah. However, when the Messiah comes on the scene, guess what happens? Prophecy is restored. Matthew chapter 3, in those days, John the Baptist came preaching in the wilderness of Judea, saying, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. For this is he who was spoken of, and this is the most important bit, by Isaiah, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Prophecy was restored just before the Lord Jesus was baptized in the River Jordan. Today, the Jews are waiting and waiting and waiting for prophecy to be restored. If they would just look to the new covenant, which God made with Israel in accordance with Jeremiah 31:31, if they would just look to the new covenant, they would see that prophecy was restored just prior to Jesus of Nazareth being baptized. That's it, folks. Next week, we're going to look at the 400 years of silence and what happened there. It's going to be really interesting because we're going to be looking at what did the Jews do with Jesus of Nazareth? What do they do with him? When he comes on the scene, what do you do with that? And ultimately, we'll finish next week looking at the destruction of the temple. Okay? That's it.